godly routine. This is, and I want you to read Matthew 6 in your own time, right? Go away, read Matthew 6, read it in different translations. So read it in King James, obviously. Read it in Amplified, read it in the Easy Read, because some of these words, it doesn't really give you much definition to what they're really meaning. The Easy Read version, I think, is one of the best explanations to give you a real understanding beyond the Shakespearean words of Matthew 6. I'm not going to read it here today because I want you to go away and like focus on that this week for your own self. But the essential focus of it is, other than faith, which is essential, obviously, to believe that God is and he's a rewarder of them that diligently seek him, secret giving, secret praying, secret fasting. And what's so funny about this is that these essentials to maintaining a godly routine and maintaining relationship is the direct antithesis to what the world is telling you to do. What does everybody do now when they want to give someone something? They got to film it. The Bible says you, when you're doing charity, you shouldn't let your left hand know what your right hand is doing. That means don't go and sound an alarm that you're doing charity. But that's what the world is doing. It's so funny how the devil has made what essentially God says not to do to be what the thing that people do and glorify. Secret praying. The Bible talks about the Pharisees who used to like to be in public and pray these long prayers to show people how holy they are. My dad always says long praying is not for public. Do that in private. Public praying is to like get to the point and whatever, but do your long praying in private, because that's where you are in your closet with God. The scripture that when you're going to read it, God is saying get in your closet and close your door. That means don't make a show of it. Get into a close, intimate relationship with God. When a man and a woman come together to have intimate relations, unless they are just disgusting, they're not doing it in front of an audience. It's in a private place. God wants to have private, intimate conversation with you. There's a scripture in Jeremiah where he's saying, Jeremiah, like, seek after me and I'm gonna tell you things that no one knows. Like, I'm gonna give you secrets. There's things that God wants to tell you that no one else is gonna know. There's things about you that no one else will know. There's things about me that no one else knows, that God knows I've done. And there's conversations I have with him I can't have with other people. Like, I love joint prayer meeting. I love coming together to pray. It's so essential. But my number one prayer is private prayer, because there's some prayers I can't pray in front of you because you might not think I'm saved. But I have to say and have certain conversations with God. You might believe, I wouldn't ever listen to this man preach or teach me. But I can say anything I want to God because I know that everything I am is not hidden from God. My life is naked before him, so I don't have to hide nothing from him. Like, people go and like say, God is scared of your nastiness. If you've done nastiness, you need to repent to God and say it how it is. In the same way you might say it to your friend on the phone, say it to God. God is not frightened of all that kind of stuff. He wants you to have that relationship where you know that, listen, you can tell me anything. You can tell me you love me and tell me how much you're grateful, and you can tell me, God, I've messed up. Please help me. I am a wretched, naked sinner. Lord, I need you to help me. Like, God is not frightened of anything, but he wants you to know that you can come to him. And then we have secret fasting. One of the things that, and we could, you know, if anybody wants it, we can do a proper teaching on fasting, because there's a lot of variations of fasting these days, but there's biblical fasting, which the scripture shows us. Right, the fasting that really is going to destroy your flesh, no food, just water, and preferably a minimum of 24 hours. When you really want to get deep and start to really, you know, and when you really get into to this type of fasting, dreams start popping off, demons start attacking, try one day, then try two, try three, and then try to go five, and then try and do 7 days, just water. And then maybe if you can do more, you can do more. I wouldn't well, some people have done 40, some people have done 30, some people have done 20, whatever the Lord leads you to do. But fasting is one sure way of just ripping your flesh apart. And actually, we should be fasting quite often. When I first got saved, I used to do 1 day a week, 24 hours, no food, just water. and I still used to go to work. It was tough, but I did it. But guess what? It was essential, because when I first got saved, I needed to really just tear up some things in my life, because obviously I was saved and but I was still coming out of darkness. So I put it this way: if you walk 100 miles in the wrong direction and you turn around and you start to go in the right direction, you still have 100 miles to walk back past everything, right? So fasting is a great way to draw closer to God and to destroy the flesh, man. Because when you're fasting, you don't have time to be running the streets and doing madness. Like, you ain't got the energy to be sinning if you're doing it correctly. Well, we can teach on that. But these are the three essential principles for maintaining a relationship with God. So I've put here, modern society and culture places so much emphasis on living your whole life in public. But if we are dead to the world and our lives are hidden with Christ in God, then what the world sees of us should be the light of God and not the light of ourselves. I'm not telling you you shouldn't have social media, but here's why I don't have social media. I set a rule for myself and I said, well, I have LinkedIn, but that's for business. The reason I don't have personal social media, because I said to myself, I don't want to put anything on LinkedIn that I wouldn't have put out to the public before social media existed. Because I realized that social media had me posting stuff that I wouldn't usually, in my usual walk of life about social media, post or put out there. And I found it became a source of promoting me rather than promoting God. Like I said, not saying you shouldn't have social media, but the point is, the world is pushing us to promote ourselves and to make us the greatest thing and the essential. Even a lot of these preachers and ministers, they're naming ministries after themselves. And actually, if you realize, all their ministry about is about their personality. It's not about God. So now people are coming to their ministry to see them. I don't want people to see me. I want them to see God in me. I want, when you see me and you hear me, you know God has done something in this young man's life. God has taken this man from somewhere and used him. And don't glory in me, glory in the God in me. And so modern culture, it glorifies men praising you, but it doesn't seek approval from God. Because there's a lot of things that men approve that God doesn't approve.